Actually, we have decided that both of us will not make this as a debate, but to complete all aspects about cysts in the donor for evaluation. As you know that, cyst is a fluid-filled sac that grows on the surface or within the kidney. And cyst characteristics may be genetic versus non-genetic, congenital versus acquired, isolated versus systemic disease, and may have malignant potential. For the classification of cystic kidney disease, may be polycystic kidney disease, or renal medullary cysts, cysts in hereditary cancer syndromes, multilocular renal cyst and variants, localized cystic disease, simple cortical cysts, acquired dialysis-induced cysts, and miscellaneous. As we know that, the polycystic kidney disease may be autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive, and other types such as glomerular kidney cyst disease. Other types such as renal medullary cysts, nephro, of course, lithiasis, autosomal recessive, medullary cystic disease with different forms, and medullary sponge kidney. And we have cysts in hereditary cancer syndromes, such as Hippel-Lindau syndrome, multinuclear renal cysts and variants, localized cystic disease, simple cortical cysts, acquired dialysis-induced cysts, and other types, which are rare types and miscellaneous types. To know that, this is Morten A. Pozniak. This is a clinical professor, Professor Emeritus of Radiology, Department of Radiology. He was the one that classified renal cysts according to sonar findings. As you can see in this classification, we may have, of course, stage 1 or type 1, just a simple benign cyst, without any septic calcifications or solid components or enhancement. Type 2, a benign cyst that may contain a few hairline thin septic and fine calcifications, but there's no, of course, enhancement or any evidence of malignancy. Type 2F, these cysts might contain more hairline thin septum, minimal enhancement of hairline thin septum, or wall can be seen, and there might be minimal thickenings of the septum or wall. Type 3, these lesions are indeterminate cystic masses that have thickened irregular walls or septum and which enhancement can be seen. Type, of course, 4, these lesions are clearly malignant cystic lesions without any debate. Category 1, usually classified as uncomplicated simple cyst with no atypical features. Category 2, minimally atypical features with little if any risk of malignancy. Category 2F, minimal concerning features requiring follow-up. Category 3, indeterminate lesion with a significant concern for malignancy. Category 4, cystic appearance but frankly malignant features. As you can see, this is the risk of transformation to malignancy in each category. Category 1 from 0 to 2%, category 2 13.7%, category 2F from 14 to 24%, category 3 50%, category 4 mostly malignant about 90%. As we can, this is very important because category 1 or type 1 simple cyst, usually you have, there is no need for more work to be done, while type 2 mildly complicated cyst, usually for follow-up by CT or ultrasound. Type 3, indeterminate lesion, usually you should follow up carefully up to 5 years because we have a risk of malignant transformation. While type 4, clear malignant cells, and of course here nephrectomy is the situation. So that 1, 2, ignore the need for follow-up, 2F follow-up, 3 to 4, either partial excision or total nephrectomy. What are your fears in cases of evaluation of your donor? Impaired kidney functions of the donors, reduced graft survival rate, malignancy transfer, missed underlying hereditary disease. This is your concern about this transfer. Most of the studies have shown that for the long-term effect regarding donors with simple cysts, usually the grafts are of a good survival rate and with good kidney functions when they are compared with normal donors. But these studies have shown that, this study, that initially in the perioperative period, you have reduced GFR when they were compared to other donors without cysts, but on the longer term, they are usually comparable to each other. And this is in the perioperative period, there is a reduction in the GFR in this study. As you can see, early reduction in the GFR, with, of course, significant between both of them. Why? Longer term, up to 15 years, there's actually no comparable difference between them. But another study have shown that in this situation, simple cystic donor kidney can influence the early and long-term allograft function in living donor transplantation. Kidney presenting cysts should be considered carefully at the time of donor selection. So that the study have shown that, as we know, that medicine is not naturally in one way. And this study showed that when we have graft from a donor with simple cysts, they have reduced for the estimated GFR, so that we also should tell our patient that still we have a risk, even if it is a minor risk. And this, of course, shows that after 5 years follow-up, we have reduced graft survival rate in the patients who have cysts. But let's discuss, this is not my lecture actually, but I discuss the special situation, the difficult situations. What about patients with postnatal 2F cyst in kidney donation? Can we, as we know that this cyst has liability in about 15% for transformation of malignancy, and it may reach up 25%. If there is any algorithm can do that, several cases have been done, and they have found that when it is done properly, we can give ordinate this kidney for the recipient without being actual risk for the recipient, because if we follow this algorithm, of course this cyst will be, of course, surgically resected from the kidney with proper analysis, and of course not to transfer from the kidney with, of course, category 2F according to SNAG categories. This is the cyst that was transported to the recipient, and when intraoperatively they had made frozen section, it showed that we have renal cell carcinoma. So that if there is an algorithm that we can donate this cyst to others, or we can make it absolute contraindication. Actually, it is not absolute contraindication. We can transfer it. Number one will ask if this unilateral or bilateral. If it is bilateral, of course, no donation, but if it is unilateral, the second question will be if this kidney with postnatal suitable for donation. If it is not suitable for donation for other causes, of course, no donation, but if it is suitable, we should go for the third question. If this cyst resectable or not, if it is not resectable, so that we should have a signed agreement from the donor for follow-up after transplantation, but if it is resectable, of course, not resectable and is not accepting, of course, no donation, but if it is resectable, I can go for donation. What about if I have transported the kidney for my recipient with this cyst 2F categorized? We should follow up to 5 years. If there is no change, there is no need for more follow-up. So that, and this has created the expanding living kidney donor criteria with ex vivo surgery for renal anomalies. Up to was previously below 1 centimeters, the condition became 4. About 2 centimeters, and now we can take cysts up to more than 4 centimeters. As you can see, we can take cysts with kidneys with a cyst about 4 centimeters, and with the presence of other large cysts inside the kidneys, without any complication actually. This is a second situation when we have a large cyst in a patient with hypertension. In this situation, as you can see, this is the cyst on the right side, and it was making partial compression on the renal vessels with ischemia and the presence of hypertension. And in this situation, they have concluded that transportation of this kidney after excision of this cyst is safe and is beneficial for both of them. Number one, you have removed this cystic lesion, and of course you don't know what about the future of being malignant transformation. Number two, in this situation, you have get rid of this abnormal kidney from the donor. Number three, the donor had improved from his hypertension situation and became towards normal. And this kidney was properly had the time for properly excision and the analysis of this cyst so that I can make up my action if I have malignancy in this cyst. This is another study shown that we can do it also for that. And this is here in this study, as we can see, this is the kidney with the cyst, and the cyst was excised intraoperatively and was, of course, transported to the recipient. What about transportation of kidneys from other cholesterol? Of course, from deceased, from living, it is absolute contraindication. This is very important. Several reports have to expand my vision for transportation, have agreed that we can take kidneys from patients or family deceased donors, which are adult polycystic kidney, and several patients have been taken in this study. It was followed for 4 years, and the kidney functions wasn't affected, and it was doing well. And this diagram showed that after transportation, the kidney functions were stabilized in my patient without any affection. Another study also shows that several patients have been taken from deceased adult polycystic kidney, and these kidneys are doing very well with long-term, up to 10 years follow-up survival rate. This is another situation where one kidney lived for 15 years with normal kidney functions and the other for 18 years after transplantation. And this was the kidney before transplantation, which was donated to the recipient. What about progression of polycystic kidney, which was recorded? As you can see on the right side, this is starting at transplantation 2006. It was variable size picture of polycystic kidney. And after 6 years, of course, there's increased size of the kidney and increased size of the cysts. And in this situation, the creatinine here became from 2 to 2.5 from normal. After 6 years, it became 2 to 2.5 milligram per deciliter. So that here in polycystic kidney, so that we have found that the rate of progression and enlargement of the kidney in case of transplantation was of lesser, and the kidney functions were stable for a longer duration. Various guidelines have supported the transportation. What about the Spanish guidelines? They have mentioned that if you have more than 2 to 3 cysts in both kidneys, you can, of course, in this situation, you will rule transportation or complex or multi-recursive. But if you have lesser than that, you can, of course, go for transplantation. And here, when you are taking a cyst, usually you should, when you have a cyst in a donor, you should take a very proper history taking, because to exclude if you have a family history of polycystic kidney disease. And in this situation, if the age is below 40 years old, usually if you have, of course, found 2 cysts or more unilaterally or laterally, this is evidence that, of course, you have other polycystic kidney disease, and please avoid your transport. Portation, but if the age is above that, you should have at least 4 cysts so that you can proceed for kidney, you can prevent kidney transplantation. And in this situation, of course, you should meet genetic screening. And even if the age is below 30 years old with a single cyst and history of polycystic kidney disease, you should go genetic screening. But of course, we have, of course, even if it's negative, it is 4% negative situation that is still had the risk for kidney transplantation, so that in this situation the position is very difficult to read. Okay, so that in any case for transplantation you should make CT, you should make screening for genetic study in this situation and genetic analysis. What about the British Transplantation Society? Plus or minus, they supported the previous results in this situation and said the same. Of course, we should make. Let's go to the KIDU guidelines. KIDU guidelines has mentioned that donor candidates with polycystic kidney should not donate. Donors candidates with a family history of kidney transplantation, of course, first degree added, may be acceptable for donation if they meet age-specific imaging or genetic testing criteria would reliably exclude other polycystic kidney disease. A kidney with a simple cyst can be left in the donor, particularly if there are compelling reasons for donating the contralateral kidney. Donation of a kidney with a postnatal renal cyst should proceed only after assessment for the presence of solid components, cytations, and calcifications. Okay, this is the last slide.
1 minute.
Okay. So that donation of a kidney with a post-nacto renal cyst should proceed only after assessment for the presence of solid components, cytations, and calcifications on the preoperative computed tomography scan or magnetic MRI course to avoid accidental transplantation of a kidney with cystic renal cell carcinoma. Donor candidates with high grade post-nacto renal cyst 3 or higher or small T1a renal cell carcinoma cured by Fermi may be accepted for donation on a case by case, of course, basis. Special situation, as we have mentioned, we can donate if you have a large cyst larger than 4 centimeters. Special situations, after discussion, we can donate if the patient, even if the patient have hypertension, we can donate even if I have multiple cysts, more than 4 cysts with, of course, more than 4 centimeters if they are proved to be simple cysts. In all our donations, we should focus, especially in young population, if they have any family history of genetic, of course, diseases, which means that if they have adult polycystic kidney disease and they have 2 cysts, unilaterally or bilaterally, I should avoid transplantation. If they have 1 cyst, I should make very good screening for genetic studies and CT and MRI. But even if it is negative for the polycystine gene type 1 and 2, still I have a risk, but a minor risk. But of course, about 40 years old, here I need really for to be 2 cysts bilaterally. It is absolute contraindication for donations. And if I'm above 60 years, if I have 4 cysts bilaterally, it is absolute, of course, contraindication for, of course, for donation. And thank you.